Sing to me, all heaven, sing my song of peace. From the cold step by me it will bring release. Burdens will be lifted that oppressing soul. Showers of great blessings on my heart will flow. Sing to me, all heaven, happy, gladly, hearty dream.
And welcome to Focus on the Bible. I am so glad that you are listening. I want to begin by inviting you to our services at Eastside. Meet at 9 o'clock for worship, followed by Bible classes for all ages at 9:30, and then at 10:30 for a second period of worship. In addition, we meet at 6 on Wednesday evenings for Bible study. We'd love to have you come and visit with us soon. Today we are continuing a series of lessons by Brother D. Bowman. He presented a series of lessons in 2015 on faith, hope, love, and heaven. And this summer, we want to spend some time with Brother Bowman as he discusses these very powerful truths from the Bible as we focus on God's Word together. And now, Brother Bowman, the lesson is titled, Faith.
I started working in a radio station when I was just a kid, 17 and a half years old. I found out right quick one thing. In order to have a broadcast, three things are necessary. You have to have a transmitter. You have to have a receiver. You have to have a message. If you have the best transmitter in the world and there's nobody tuned in, you have no transmission. And could I say something to you preachers? That's what it's all about. If the audience doesn't get your point, you haven't made a communication. So I'm saying to you that if you don't have a receiver, there can be no transmission. If you have the best receiver in the world and there's no message being transmitted, you don't have communication. By the same token, if you have the best receiver and the best transmitter that anybody ever made, the strongest that you can buy, and you don't have a message to transport, you have nothing. So there has to be all three of those things. And that's what faith's all about. Faith is a transmitted message received by the one who is being addressed. It's always that way. And this is what he's saying to Thomas here. Blessed are those who have not seen yet believe. The evidence should have constrained him. He should have seen that. He did not. And many other signs, he says now, truly did Jesus in the midst of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, how? That you might believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through His name. Jesus Christ, as we read from Hebrews chapter 12, is the author and finisher of our faith. He's the one who institutes the faith. He's the one that finishes the faith. He makes the faith become a reality at the end of matters. But until that time, there's the transmitted message that tells you who He is, what He is, why He is, where He is, and what He says to you as an individual. How you can deport yourself in accordance with His will. That's what faith is all about. Man is the most interesting of God's creation. He's the only part that has any real being about him. The rest of it's just kind of hodgepodge to take care of the man, actually. Man is, well, Paul describes him as saying in his message to the Areopagites, in him we live and move and have our very being. That pretty well describes man. In him we live, that is, we have life. In him we move, we have actuality, we can choose, we have a will, and we have our very being. Every personality is different than every other personality. Every one of us lives, moves, and have our very being. And he appeals to that by faith. He appeals to that by faith. He doesn't have to stand in front of you and say, I'm God. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. But it does not tell us what he wants us to do. It does not tell us where to go. It does not tell us when to move and when not to. It does not tell us when we transgress and when we do transgress what to do about it. It doesn't do that. Faith is intended to tell you what God wants you to know. So these things are written that you might believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that believing you might have life through his name. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Let me say that again. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and I never expect to entertain any doubt about that. And I'll tell you why I believe. Because I believe he came, I believe he died, I believe he was buried, I believe he was resurrected, I believe every miracle that he did, and because I believe who he was and what he was and when he was, I believe everything he says to be the truth. And that takes me to the Bible, see? The fact of the matter is, faith in Jesus Christ is the predicate on which the entirety of the Christian system rests. And I would be out of order to say that I believe in any kind of a faith-only idea. I don't. There's no such thing. But the fact of the matter is, faith is the basic foundation, the fundamental fact, the fundament on which the entirety of the Christian system rests. It all depends on whether or not you believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Now turn to another passage. Come with me to Romans chapter 10. These things are written that you might believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that believing you might have life through his name. I'm at Romans chapter 10 this time, and I'll begin reading in verse 8 with your kind permission. Romans chapter 10, verse 8. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. It is the word of faith which we preach. Now, bear those definitions in your mind. Faith is agreement with an affirmation that has been substantiated by evidence. Remember that? He says, but what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of truth which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord is over all, rich unto all that call upon him. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? If I were going to just choose a word from the Oxford English Dictionary, I would choose the word sequence, sequential. One thing follows another in natural order. Listen to it. How shall they believe? How shall they call on him, first of all, in whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? That's the next sequence. How shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Why are the gospel is preached in order to make believers? When you find somebody who says, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, you have no trouble when he says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. When you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, you have no trouble believing what he said about the church, what he said about worship, what he said about religion in general. So he is saying here by sequence, the Word of God is propagated when the gospel of Jesus Christ is preached and then when it's believed. Let me give you another simple illustration. Words are vehicles of thought. Let me say it again. Words are vehicles of thought. They're little cars that we load up with thought. And when we put those vehicles of thought together, we make a train of thought. And when we take a train of thought and run it on a track from one place to another, we have an exchange or an expression or a conversation. And that's what he's saying here. He's saying everything is produced by the use of the Word of God, finding its place, a dwelling place, residency, if you please, in the heart of the person to whom it's presented. How shall they call on him who they have not heard? People don't call on Jesus when they've never heard of him. They'll call on him, though, after they find out that he did all the miracles that he did. They'll call on him when they find out that he was buried and was resurrected again the third day. They'll call on him when they do that. And they need somebody to present the information so they can have the faith to call on him and say, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The Ethiopian, Acts 10, Acts 8. He's going along there and he's being preached to. He began at the same passage and preached to him baptism. He began at the same passage and preached to him baptism. He did not begin at the same passage and preached to him baptism. He began at the same passage and preached unto him Jesus. When you preach Jesus and you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, you'll say, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? I'm ready. Because the fact of the matter is, he is the Son of God, and he has a right to say what he wants to say.
Join us for the continuation of this lesson next week. Thank you so much. Have a great and wonderful day.
Some black boys.